Becoming the Man by Marcus Slade, Chapter 1, Mr. White. He was having one of those dreams that's timed perfect with the alarm clock. The kind where right after feeling your feet slowly slip off the cliff or opening that door to be surprised by almost seeing your biggest fear, you're awakened by the buzzer that signals the start of your reality. His reality started with the same sound every morning for the past 35 years or so. The dull gray alarm clock with the outdated orange radio screen was a good analogy of his life. While people all across America were being awakened by the latest digital technology attempting to keep up with the times, it was his job to wake up every day, camouflage the past, and weave it into the fabric of the future. Minutes turned to hours, hours turned to days, and the days turned into 3 decades of the monotonous task of being the man. It felt good to know that his meeting with the higher-ups could actually result in the approval of his retirement request. After all, it was well overdue. His run at his government position was actually the second longest in United States history, and it wasn't like money was an issue. His job paid extremely well, allowing him to make investments and buy real estate in little coastal towns in South Africa where only white people have money. The almighty dollar used to justify the importance of his job, but at this point he realized that had he never had the title to begin with, he might have been better off. After trying his best to remember the start of the dream he was just submerged in, he rolled out of his king-size bed and prepared for his drive. After his morning routine, which included admiring his own work in the local crime section, he climbed into his black Chevy Suburban and started the 26-mile drive from his suburban cul-de-sac to his nondescript office downtown. He zipped down his neighborhood's main artery, running through 5 consecutive yellow lights. He could have stopped. In all reality, he could have slept in. He made his own hours anyway. Waking up at the same time every day just made his work seem more meaningful. He merged onto the interstate to the chatter of a political talk radio show. The issue at hand was race and some celebrity who had recently made racist comments in public. He found these conversations particularly amusing. He did admire the naivety of people who called in with the so-called solutions to society's ills. How could they be cured when it was his duty to hide the medicines? After a stretch of stop-and-go morning traffic, he looked down at his gas gauge and realized he hadn't filled up since picking up his dry cleaning on Saturday. "I'm going to have to talk to one of these guys about these gas prices if I get a chance," he said aloud to himself. He exited off the interstate and drove towards the closest gas station. The gas station itself was his work illustrated perfectly. It was positioned right on a street where a black and Hispanic neighborhood met. An Arabic man who spent his money nowhere near the place owned the store. He remembered stopping there before, even though most people, any race, that weren't from the neighborhood would have been uneasy. He stopped at Pump 7 with an unmatched confidence, almost like an artist walking through the art gallery that's displaying his work on opening night. Upon getting out, he was approached by an African-American male who appeared to be in his mid-40s, obviously on drugs and possibly still drunk from the week before. The man spoke, exposing the spaces that once held all of his teeth, except the remaining 6. "What's up there, sir? Let me get that gas for you, brother. Help a brother out, man. I'm just out here trying to do me, you know. Let me get that for you, man." He handed the pump to the man, along with the $1.14 that sat in his ashtray. He figured it was easier to cooperate for $1.14 than to resist and have to deal with a persistent crackhead. For a second, he saw the down-and-out man as a person. He wondered what his dream had been, who, if anyone, still loved him, and where his life took the wrong turn. They say life is about the choices one makes, but who would consciously choose such an existence? What were the direct factors that had to have played into this man finding himself in these situations day after day? Reduced to putting forth all of his earthly energy from sunrise to past sunset towards getting high and destroying his self. He quickly snapped out of it when his cell phone rang. "Hello?" Hey, and good morning to you, big guy," the voice on the other end said. The caller spoke like a baseball coach, like a coach pulling up to the field at the same time as his star pitcher as they sit in the stadium parking lot in drop-top Bentleys. Now realizing that even answering the call took too much focus away from his newly found strung-out friend, he quickly replied, "Hey, let me run. If we're still on for the meeting, I'll talk to you then." He hung up the phone, saying no more. When you were an ace that put up the numbers he had over his secretive career, people respected your time, down to the greetings and the goodbyes, or lack thereof. He thanked the man who had pumped the gas and who had by this time put down the gas pump and began eyeing up the immaculate back seat of the SUV even through the deep black tint. He regained his focus and continued his ride to work. The building he worked at sat on a street right on the edge of the financial district of the city. It was very cookie cutter. It was next to a bank and a financial consulting company. On the sunniest days, the street was a tunnel of shadows. When he was younger, he did everything he could to avoid working inside the office, but nowadays he liked the solitude. Besides the higher-ups, no one in the building, the city, or the world for that matter, even knew what he did in that office. That was the main reason why it didn't matter whether he even showed up or not. He could have woken up at a different time every day for the last 3 decades. As a matter of fact, when he was being sold on the job, he remembered Mr. Giles asking, "How would you like to wake up when you want and make your own hours?" The daily routine he had created for himself was just an attempt to make his life normal, some kind of solid existence to grab onto. It takes a very complex man to live the life he led. Judging by the paneling in the elevator and the 1970s smell to it, you would never be able to grasp the magnitude and the effect that Mr. White's job had on the world. How could one of the most influential men in the history of the world work in this building? On the 4th floor, the bell sounded and the elevator door opened. It was a cleaning staff member who worked at the building as well. The two men, both very close to retirement, stood awkwardly as the elevator rose slowly towards the 9th floor. The man with the bucket had no idea that the keeper of the peace, the creator of the chaos, the one who stretches the canvas that the present is painted on before it is displayed in its final splendor as the past, stood next to him casually. The two men reached their floor and parted ways down the hallway in very separate directions. Mr. White rounded the corner and headed for door number 916. He unlocked the door with the gold-colored key, one of three on his chain. He walked into the absurdly generic office. It was once decorated with comfortable but hip furniture and fine modern art. These things ended up being a distraction. Art and furniture and sculptures and college degrees hanging on a wall invoke memories and emotions. Memories and emotions lead to feelings. Feelings lead to regret and remorse. Remorse and regret lead to hesitancy. And hesitancy leads to weakness. Over 20 years ago, he had the office stripped down to nothing but the deep reddish-brown walls, a nice solid oak desk with a globe rather than a plant, his comfy black chair, a secure telephone line, and his supercomputer that he called Rusty. Rusty held secrets. His database was designed to seek and destroy. At the push of a button, it calculated race-crippling algorithms. It was connected to the central banking systems, every state's computer database, every police department in the United States, the colleges, the public schools, the military, and everywhere else you could imagine. The search engines that are now being made available to the public are what Rusty was using when Mr. White's predecessor had the job in the early 60s. Rusty had the power to influence any life that had any ties to a computer. If you ever applied for a job, if you ever even had an address or a birth date, you were well within Rusty's villainous grasp. Mr. White put down his briefcase and sat down at the computer. He logged in with his password, "The Man." It always made him laugh to think that those 6 words, 7 characters with the space in between, were the only thing really keeping African-American communities across the whole country in a state of despair. He checked his daily charts, reports, and things of that nature. By now, everything was smooth sailing. The work in the system that he had designed every day for decades now worked like they say, a well-oiled machine. He saw on his screen, like every other day, crime on the rise, drugs on the rise, education on the fall, and so forth. There was nothing new, and it was even kind of redundant. Every 8 or so years, the higher-ups would owe somebody a favor somewhere, maybe the Pentagon, maybe even the White House. They would call on him for the favor. Can you make these crime numbers go down? Or, come on, Philadelphia is making us look bad with the convention coming up. Is there anything you can make happen for the next month or so? He didn't really mind. It made the job seem a little more interesting, and in a way, it was his way of getting to do some good. At least for 1 month or so, crime was down, he would think to himself. Today, however, was not one of those days. The phone on his desk rang. He still had the old touch-tone phone with the three-dimensional stick-out buttons and the old-school bell ring. The only people who had the number were the higher-ups who worked on the 14th floor. There was no 13th. Mr. White picked up the phone, and the voice on the other end said quite excitedly, "White, baby, what's the good news, man? Don't tell me you got some dirt on Bill Cosby." "You are absolutely nuts," Mr. White replied calmly. "I'm coming to see you guys. We have some things to discuss." Mr. White hung up the phone just as quickly as he had picked it up. The higher-ups were two people you wish you never had to meet or know. They were deplorable human beings. They saw themselves as too smart to believe in God, but at the same time, they were smart enough to know that if there was a God, they were front-running candidates for a prime slot in his hell. As a matter of fact, their quest for gain at the expense of anything was their twisted way of preparing for the possibility of it. In other words, if there was no hell, they made out great. If there was a hell, well, at least those 78.6 years on Earth were very pleasing. And there were two of them. Mr. White assumed that somehow they had to be related. Maybe cousins, half-brothers. They had similar enough features. They had thick, curly, dark brown hair with no signs of balding or gray, and they also wore tailor-made black suits. They had jovial demeanors which lay on top of a sinister core. Mr. White remembered them planning the robbery of an art museum in Baghdad while they were playing checkers. That memory always stuck out because he found it odd that two people who had the power to control the fate of humanity were playing checkers and not chess. At first glance, you would think that they were definitely lawyers. Mr. White never cared too much for them and tried to keep all contact with his only two direct bosses minimal. In the back of his mind, he was hoping that this would be the last time he ever had to see them. He got up from his chair, grabbed his briefcase, locked the door, and headed upstairs to the office of the higher-ups.